I'm Pastor Troy here with a very special episode for you. We did in season two a special show called Well Done, Lives Well Lived series. This was a season two episode with multiple people involved. But I want you to get ready for a special two episode, season two encore, in honor of my grandfather, Don Benitone. He's the first person we featured on it. He was one of those people who had lives well lived, but now it's a life well lived. We do this in honor of Don Benitone, that show from season two. He was here when he turned 100, November 16th, 1921. He was born. And I just want you to see a picture. I'm going to show a little pride here. This is Don, my dad. He was the only Benitone male able to breed in the world. He had five sons and a daughter. That's all of the Don, Jerry, and my five other siblings there. Then look at this picture here. This is at his 100th year birthday party. That's all of his grandchildren then. There's several more since, 18 grandchildren, eight great-great-grandchildren, and yes, there may be a couple more coming here real soon. And Grandpa, since that time that he was on the show, let me show you a couple more. The Quilt of Valor Foundation, Little Egypt Quilters, and the Illinois State Senate honored Don at his 102nd birthday. He's wearing his Army jacket from World War II. It fits him. That's crazy. He was 19. He's wearing it as Mayor Fortini honors him. And then you see Dale Fowler, state senator from Illinois, honoring him at Heron City Hall for his 102nd birthday. And then you get to see a picture. This is vanity, pure vanity. Five generations of Benitones there. You see Don. You see my dad. You see myself. You see my son, Josh. And you see my granddaughter, Ezzy. So five Benitones there. That's my sister also, and one of my brothers, Tyler, in the picture. And yes, Grandpa, at 102 years and 8 months, was walking. I took this picture coming up to his house just a month ago. He was doing his half-mile morning walk. Yes, there's an afternoon half-mile walk as well. That's the secret to living to 102 and a half, and he eats oats every day. And as always, it's exhausting being a Benitone clan leader. And I one of the most treasured pictures I have is my sister was up here this summer, very late in the summer. He's probably 102 and 7-8 months here, and she goes to church with him. And Grandpa takes the steps. He refuses to use the elevator at the Heron Methodist Church. Granddaughter Don and Tiffany, they share the same birthday, November 16th. He likes her the best of all of us. He always liked my sister better than all of us, and we're all okay with it. They had a special bond. And it's him going to church. And finally, the Benitone clan. Remember, one man, one son. Look at the clan now. Looks like he did all right. And this is Don. Last picture I got, I'm really good, is him heading off to the next great adventure, as always. So we're celebrating in this special encore presentation, An Amazing Life, Don Benitone. Yes, November 16, 1921, but he passed away and went to be with the Lord on August the 20th, 2024. So we salute him. Well done. Lives Live Well series. Get ready right now. We're going to be running this two-episode special season two encore in honor of Don Benitone, my grandpa. Sure proud to have him as my grandpa. Hope I can come close to his footsteps. A life well lived. Pastor Troy, and you're on the dock with us here. We're glad to have you with us today. I'm on the dock with, we're going to have a good time. Got my lovely wife next to me. Let me get you introduced to the show. I know you're enjoying our incredible shows that have been going out, and we have got a great one, a new series starting for you today. But let me just remind you real quick, On the Dock is all about conversations that will propel your faith out of the shallows and into the deep. That's what we're about. That's what we've been doing. That's what we're going to do. That's what we're going to keep doing. We're going to bring people to you that can coach you, get you prepared and equipped so you can get off the dock and get out there and live for the greater things of Jesus Christ. Hey, just a reminder, we're available on multiple platforms. Our biggest platform is YouTube. We want you to find us on YouTube if you can. Like us, subscribe, hit like, notify. You can get notified every time we go up. Also, iTunes and Spotify got great bite there. A lot of people listening that way. You can also use Google Play. You can watch us on Facebook, Roku, Rumble, Sermonet. Sermonet. On Sermonet, it's a little catchy. Sermonet, download the app, or you can watch it on your computer. Roku, if you have Roku TV, you have to actually download the Sermonet app itself and then look for the On the Dock with Pastor Troy channel. We also got multiple social media partners. Let me mention those. Got a brand new one here. We got Facebook, Instagram, Twitter. Listen to this. Telegram. And we have now added, oh, you don't have the new Getter one in there. We have it on the main one. Drop those lower thirds. There you go. Far right, lower corner. We've got Getter with us now. We have a new lower third for that. We got to load up. Yeah, but if you haven't already, go to those different sites. Again, hit the subscribe, hit the like, hit the notify, share it with other people, get it out there. Also, we'll remind you that we use Patreon. If you want to become one of our partners, we have multiple tiers, and we'd love to have you. We have 4 different partner tiers. Check that out. That's how you can support us and become a part of our show. And also, we have 3 different tiers. If you'd like to be a sponsor, you're a business owner, got an organization, you'd like to get stuff out there, we've got 3 tiers there. Go check it out at my Patreon. Look for On the Dock with Pastor Troy. There's lots of details there. We'd love to talk to you about that. If you got any other questions, you can always go to us at onthedock.org. That's our website. You can always email us at info@onthedock.org. Our executive director, our executive producer, Donna Karnuski, will get a hold of you, get a hold of me, get all your questions answered. We love that. And just want to tell you, I've got with me today, to my right, my lovely co-host, my lovely wife, Mother Beth Benitone. Good morning, Mother. You doing well this morning?
Good. I'm doing good. How are you?
Excellent. We're ready to go here. I've also got in the room our techno wizard, our executive director, Lucas Winkler. Lucas is in the room this morning. He's running all the boards and making sure you see all these good things. And in just a minute, we'll introduce you to our incredible guest for the day. The whole series that we're doing here, we kind of put this together just recently. Just was kind of inspired. I was over in doing a study. I'm focusing this year heavily on the book of Matthew. So Matthew's kind of, I'm doing an intensive study. Our church is doing it on Wednesday nights. You can always check out our Wednesday night feeds at Community Faith Church, where I pastor. You can look at the Wednesday services. You can look at those on Sermonet as well, or maybe YouTube or Facebook under Community Faith Church. We've been studying Matthew 7. I went through it heavily earlier this year, and now I'm teaching it more in depth. But when I was in Matthew 25 doing my planning for this, I got hung up in Matthew chapter 25 in the parable of the talents. And I got thinking, it says in the parable of talents that, you know, you have these guys where they were given 5 gifts and 2 gifts and 1 gifts. The owner, the master went away. He came back after some time and he said, guys, show me what you've made. The guy with 5 had doubled it. He had 10. The guy that 2 had doubled it. He had 4. And the guy that had 1 said, hey, I knew you were a harsh man. I knew that you were difficult and expected a lot. So I went and buried it. And basically here's your one thing back. In other words, he had buried his talent, not used it. The others had really done things that they took good care of the money and they literally doubled it. And we know that the man that had 10 was given the 1 by the servant because he said, take what he's got, give it to the one that did the best. And so the guy that got 5, they got 10, he got the 11th. The guy that got 2 got the 4, and the guy that had the 1 and buried it, he got put out. And what it says about the 2 servants in the Bible, both in Matthew 25, verse 21 and 23, it's identical text. It says to the 2 that took their talents and used them for the Lord, it said, the Lord said to him, well done, good and faithful servant. You were faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many things. Enter into the joy of your Lord. It says that for both of the people that took their gifts, their natural talents, they took what they were given and they applied it to the very best they could. And they did their lives well and they were rewarded for doing that. The one that buried the talent, he doesn't quite hear that. He's told he'll be thrown out where there'll be the gnashing of teeth. He'll be separated and he doesn't get the well done. And I got really thinking about the concept of well done. And I know this is crazy. I'm not promoting anything negative here, but I just got to tell you where it comes from. I know it's not good. I was thinking about the Dos Equis commercial, Beth. The Dos Equis commercial, Lucas is laughing. Oh my God, where is he going with this? The Dos Equis. I know it's a beer commercial, but everybody knows the picture of this incredible man. He's the most interesting man in the world. Uh-huh. The commercial says, I'm the most interesting man in the world. You know, I'm the most intriguing man in the world. I don't remember what the guy's name is. Anybody remember what the guy's name was? No. He had a name or something, but I don't know. He looks like Ricky Ricardo, you know, Carlos Montalban. Yeah, I don't know. I'm the most interesting man in the world, you know, and when I need to drink a beer, I drink Dos Equis, you know, and everybody wants to be like him because look at him. He's suave, right? He's a guy that everything's well done. So I got thinking about, you know, who are some of the most interesting men in my life? who are some people that I think that have done well? Mm-hmm. Who are people that have touched and influenced me? People that for me would be my, not my Dos Equis man, but who would be my Bible man? Who would be my God-fearing man? Who would be my God-fearing ladies? Who would be those people that I think if I were asked, these would be some of the most amazing people in my world. And who would I put on the cover of my ad? Troy's most intriguing men and women of God. And so that led me to kind of come up with a list of people. And that's what we're going to be looking at in this series. This new series is entitled Well Done Lives, Well Lived Series. Now we're going to be talking to people that are alive. They're not done. But these are people that I think are my intriguing people of God. And we're going to be bringing them in the studio. And we're going to let them, really, we're just going to get them on board and let them talk. So you're going to see a lot of these people come in and maybe do multiple episodes with the conversation because we want to fit our length. We try to run the podcast 35 to 45 minutes. Every now and then we go a little longer. So we'll break these up as needed. But we're going to bring in some incredible people to talk to you about their lives that are well done, lives well lived. And we're going to just talk with them because I think they can inspire you like they have me to kind of say, hey, if they can do that, I can do that, Beth. Mm-hmm. And we're not going to sell beer here at all. But what we're going to sell is the opportunity for you to experience some incredible things from people on the dock. And then hopefully they'll inspire your lives to get out there and live well. What do you think, Beth?
I think it's fabulous.
Fabulous idea. Well, we got our first guest in the studio. This is a guest of personal privilege. And, you know, they're all personal privilege because we invite who we want to invite. That's what we do here on the dock here. But you seem to be enjoying it. Thank you for everybody that's listening to all our shows. But got an incredible guest. He's sitting across the table from me. He is an incredible man. He is a centenarian. In just a few days here, November 16th, 2021, he will be a centenarian, which means he is a man of 100 years of age.
Not a centurion.
Yeah, not a centurion. A centurion is a soldier over 100. A centenarian is a man of 100 years.
There you go.
He's a centenarian, and he is my grandfather, Don Benitone. Don, Grandpa, welcome to the studio here.
Thank you.
All right, good. He's going to get you. Try it again, Grandpa. Welcome to the studio.
I'm glad to be here.
There you go. He had your microphone on. There you go. I've got up on the board picture, Grandpa. What's up on the screen there is actually what's on the TV is I've got, this is my grandpa through the ages. He's got his young photo there in that hat. You look great in that hat. That's that picture of you in that hat. Man, you look good. Then you got his military picture when he's in the Army, and he looks, very handsome there. He's teaching here in a school setting. This is later in his life. And then the lower right picture is just recently this year during COVID. One of our friends, was it our granddaughter, Beth?
One of her friends.
I needed to do an interview with somebody of Grandpa's age and background. And so he did a Zoom interview with her, and he was all dressed up doing a Zoom interview. So Grandpa's used to this. Grandpa, I put four pictures up there because when you're a centenarian, one picture doesn't just cut it. We got to see the package. And man, you've had a great life, and you're 100 years old. Let me share this other graphic here real quick. We are all excited. Your family's all coming together and having a crazy party for you. But I just want to say to you right now, Grandpa, happy 100th birthday. It's coming up for you here. We're celebrating that with you, and hope everybody out there will give him his best wishes. Grandpa still lives alone. He has his own home.
Right.
Did you make your own breakfast this morning?
Yes.
Made your own breakfast. Car still sits in his driveway. He can still drive. It makes you nervous when he does, but he can drive. He can drive. Yeah. He's a good guy. He's got cats outside that are his pets, and he's got a large yard. How big is your yard?
About half a yard.
Well, you got like a half acre.
Yeah.
Half acre. Yeah. He's got a half acre, and he mows it himself. I don't know. He's a very smart man. My grandfather is, but he did plant sycamore ball trees, gumball trees. It's the one thing you probably wish he never did. They're beautiful trees. They're huge, but he has a constant battle against the sycamore balls.
Yeah.
Wouldn't you say?
Yes.
You see him out there fighting them. You fight them.
Gumballs.
The gumballs are his arch nemesis. Yeah. Arch nemesis. But the trees are beautiful. I asked him, I said, Grandpa, why'd you do that? He said, well, they're pretty today, but they're horrible. We should have gone with oak trees or something like that. Yeah. Yeah. At least the squirrels would have picked the acorns up and you wouldn't have to pick them up. There's nothing good that comes from a gumball. They're just one of those things that the Lord gives you a pretty tree and tricks you with what falls off it and sticks into your feet all the time. So Grandpa, welcome to On the Dock. We're glad to have you here. We are honored to have you in our studio. Tell us a little bit about, you were born, what year were you born?
1921.
That's before the Great Depression, right?
Yes.
You obviously didn't jump out of a building, but you were a child during the Great Depression, I guess.
Yes.
How did that impact your life, being a child in the Great Depression?
You didn't know any different. Just whatever. It's just part of life.
Did you do without stuff, or did you were ever things ever hard to get, or did you always have food on the table?
We always had something, yes.
Yeah, your parents were great providers. They worked hard.
Yes.
Yeah, and they did it. So hey, people always talk about that. I know Grandma lived on the farms in Tennessee, tobacco farms in Tennessee, and she often talks about the Great Depression, having to eat chickens nonstop for weeks and months at a time, or corned beef nonstop. Grandma wouldn't even eat corned beef when we were like, even in her 90s, she didn't like corned beef because she says, I ate it during the Depression. I don't want to eat it again. She had to do that. So it was an interesting time. Grandpa, I want to start with these pictures here. You were born in 1921. Where were you born?
Heron.
In Heron. Were you born at home in the hospital here?
Home.
You were born in your home. So were you born in your parents' home? In your parents' home? Where you live now, yeah, today, you're right there. So if I'll tell you about this. Grandpa lives at 2517 North 13th Street. Don't go visit him, but you can send him a card. He lives there, and his parents were the next door, and was at 2513. Yeah. So his parents' home was right there. I've seen pictures of it where it was kind of, there wasn't a lot of other houses out there in that time, were there?
No.
No, it was the Burns house wasn't there. Your house wasn't there. So it was pretty, you could see all the way to the main road. Yeah.
There's one house next to the church.
And that's it. The Free Methodist Church is nearby. And right. You can see the whole area is a very developed area now. Grandpa built his home on land that his dad gave him adjacent to their home. So he's lived his whole life in either 2513 or 2517 North 13th Street, with the exception of his time with the U.S. Army in World War II when he was stationed overseas. So he has lived in those places pretty much his whole life, other than maybe when he went to college. He lived in McKendree while he was at college and stuff like that. But he's basically grew up in Heron, Illinois, right near the old Free Methodist Church. Not a church now, it's now a home, but he's grown up in that same community, and he's been there the entire time. So how did you were born in Heron. How did your parents, my grandparents, how did they get to Heron themselves? How did Charlie and Ruby get to Heron?
Dad came for a job, coal miner.
He's a coal miner.
That's the reason he was in Heron. There were coal mines.
And they came here originally from New Mexico.
Yes.
Correct. And hey, I'm going to show you something on the doc here. You're going to love this. I'm going to show it to us now. Up on the screen, Grandpa, is our family's citizenship papers. I was studying those. I actually have the original set. They're hanging in my living room. The original ones are. Grandpa gave them to Dad. Dad gave them to me when I had my sons. And I gave my sons one at their wedding days. And my intention is the first one of them that have a male heir is to pass that on to them. And I've got the original. They've got a copy of it like this is. And we're going to swap them someday. But just to point out, I was reading this thing. I didn't realize how long it took to become a citizen. If you read this thing, what you find out is in New Mexico, my grandpa Charlie came over. His dad was Antonio. So they came over to be coal miners. Beth. Uh-huh. And what were they mining in New Mexico?
Coal.
Was it coal there too? Coal. So they came over, they were doing coal there. And it says here on the paperwork, if you go read it, it says that he began the process to become a citizen, A. Benitone, on October 16th, 1894. At that time, Mexico was a territory. Okay. Mm-hmm. And then it's not finalized till May 1st, 1915. So the time he filed to become a citizen to the time it was signed. Matter of fact, if you read the back of it, it shows the 1894 date on the left. And if you look down at the lower right, it shows the May 1915 when it was signed. They actually had to cross out where it said territory, and they now wrote in that New Mexico is a state. So originally, he applied to be a citizen in a U.S. territory, and by time the court said you've done your period of time and you're now official. You started the petition, then you had to go through a process. It took over 10 years to make that from the first petition with the court, more than 10 years.
Almost 20.
Almost 20 years to actually become a legal citizen of the United States. And you can see in the middle of the right-hand side where he has to swear off his allegiance to the King of Italy, We had to do that. So it took our great-great-grandpa, it took him a while to become a citizen. Worked hard. And then Grandpa Charlie moved here, and you were born here. Your sister June was born here as well?
Yes.
And Charles, your brother Charles?
Yes.
So all of y'all were born in Heron?
Yes.
Wow. And you're the oldest?
No.
No?
My sister.
Your sister. June's older than you?
Yeah.
Well, who would have known that? Yeah, I guess June always talked to you like an older sister. So so Grandpa has two other siblings. June's passed. We she's gone home to be with the Lord. And how about Charles?
He's gone.
He's gone too. So you're the last of your siblings living today. Yeah. And then Grandpa, if you know anything about this, June did not have any daughters. I mean, she had daughters, but she didn't have sons. Hmm. Charles didn't have any sons either, did he? He didn't have any sons either. He had a daughter, right?
Mm-hmm.
But Grandpa was terribly productive in the having of kids. He had one child. Grandpa had one child. Let me show you. Grandpa had one child, and that one child. I'm going to show you a picture of the one child because I can do that. All right, upper left hand corner. There's my Grandma Mamie. We'll talk about her in a minute. But there's my dad Jerry, the one Benitone heir, the one. Antonio, Charlie, you have Don, and you have Jerry. I mean, they're real productive. They have like all these girls and one son. So you had one son to keep on the legacy. That was it. If dad has all girls, the Benitone name goes into extinction. Isn't that correct?
Yeah.
Yeah, pretty bad. You had to be nervous with that. So fortunately, dad did really well. Dad has very good Italian male lineage seed. I'm going to show you this. The upper right-hand picture. Excuse me, guys. The upper right-hand picture is my family. So that's my dad, Jerry, in the upper right. I'm the fat kid behind my dad to the right. I'm Troy. My oversight's Todd. And you see Tiffany, my sister. Then underneath these, Trevor, Tyler, and Trent. And that's my mom, Donna. She's with the Lord already as well. But that's our family. Grandpa ends up having five grandsons to carry on the legacy. And you now have 17 great-grandchildren. A lot of guys, kids being produced. I mean, we're producing grandkids. So the lineage of Benitones went from one funnel, and it looks to me like it's pretty big. How does that feel, being 100 years old and knowing that your name and your legacy will live on through the lives of many people you've had impact on for ages to come? How do you feel about that?
I haven't given much thought to that, really.
Well, is it better? What would happen if you just had one and then it had been done? Wouldn't that be kind of sad?
Yeah.
It's kind of nice to see you feel a little bit like Noah sometimes. You come out and go, you know, or Abraham and the seeds of the sand. My grandchildren are like the sands of the sea or the stars in the sky. You're very blessed like that.
Right on.
I remember Grandpa Charlie. Grandpa Charlie wasn't a man of any notable faith. Grandma Ruby was a woman of great faith.
Yeah.
Grandpa Charlie said he lived on in the, he pointed a finger at us grandkids and he says, I live on in you guys. And I'm going to live on well because there's many of you. So Grandpa Charlie was always, he loved his grandchildren. Your dad loved his grandchildren. And we are his legacy. While you're looking at that picture there, to the left of that picture, Lucas, you're going to love this. The middle picture is, to the left of that picture in the middle, that's my Grandpa Charlie. That's my great-grandpa. I grew up with my great-grandpa. My great-grandpa was more like my grandpa than grandpa was. Grandpa was young and vibrant. He had a motorcycle. I'd go to grandpa's house. He worked. He had a school job. He had an insurance job. Grandpa worked hard. He worked hard into his, when he should have retired, he was still working. But Grandpa Charlie, I never knew Grandpa Charlie working. Now, he was a retired coal miner. So, but I never knew him as a miner. I just knew him retired and he had the garden. And so when I come up to visit, as soon as I got up, I went over and hung out at Grandma Ruby and Charlie's. I just walk out the door in my sock and my bare feet and walk across, and Grandma Ruby would have something for me and Grandpa Charlie. And they always ate lunch at noon. It was always good. Grandpa Charlie kind of kept the books up at the Eagles Club, and that's what he did, you know, and he kept his garden. So that's Grandpa Charlie. To the right of that is Grandma Ruby. She's just a little firecracker. And then I guess, Don, that's you in the back. The woman is that woman next to you, is that Mamie or is that June?
I can't tell.
You can't tell?
No.
Yeah, I would assume one of those is Mamie, one of those is June, And the little one, I assume, is Jerry. And so I thought the reason I put this picture together, I thought you'd enjoy that, is the far left picture is Grandpa Don standing with my dad, who's pretty blonde at that time. My dad's got very black hair now, if you see that. And standing with my dad at a tree, that's where his dad's house is, which is, I mean, there's only 50 feet between the two houses. Yeah. And then what's great is you got to picture me back there. My dad and I are both got blonde hair, and we both today have darker hair. So I just thought it was interesting to see four generations of Benitones there. With our grandkids now, we're seeing five, and God's really doing a great thing. So, I mean, you're almost like Abraham now. You don't feel like Father Abraham? So did you coal mine at all?
No.
You didn't coal mine?
I spent one day in the coal mine.
Why one day?
I wanted to see what it was. I was interested. It was terrible.
Tell us, what did the coal mines look like in what year? About what time would that have been? How old were you then?
12, 13.
12, 13 years. So 90 years ago, you went down in a coal mine and took a look at it.
Yeah. And there's low coal, you call it.
Low, so yeah. Real small walls, short?
Yeah.
So you had to kind of crouch down a little bit. Yes, terrible. And so you went down there and thought, this life's not for me.
That's right.
And Grandpa Charlie spent his whole life down there.
That's right.
Man, he was a tough man, wasn't he?
Yes.
Yeah, I could see that. And they, right in the mines around here in Southern Illinois, that was the way of life at the time. Right. So what did you do after that? What you came out of the mine and said, the mine's not for me. What did you decide to do?
Go to school.
Go to school. Did you do well in school?
Rather well.
Did you go to school out at Chittyville?
Chittyville.
Yeah.
Graduated eighth grade.
And went to Heron High School?
Heron High.
Okay. And then after Heron High, somewhere toward the end of high school, we would have gone into World War II, right?
Right.
So where were you in your high school, college stuff when you got drafted? Did you get drafted or did you sign up?
I was drafted.
You were drafted. And so you got drafted. Were you done with high school? You got drafted. So what, when you got drafted for World War II, where were we at? What was going on in the war when you got drafted? Were we already in the war? Were we kind of deep into it? Did you get called up right before it started?
No, it was going pretty good. Terrible.
It was going terrible. If you'd have been in the coal mine, would they have drafted you? Would they have left you doing coal? Did they draft the coal miners?
Some. Basically, it was a necessary job. So
coal miners would have been protected in general because they need to produce coal to run the plants. So would you, when you look back at it, would you have rather gone back into the coal mine or would you have rather gone to the war?
I'd rather go to the war.
Oh, my. Hey. Well, yeah.
I think
I would have too. Because everybody knows, well, if you don't know this, I'm extremely claustrophobic. There's no way I'm going down the low coal hole. No, I would much rather take my chance fighting the Germans. And I know that was no picnic either, but I couldn't live down in those holes.
So were there people that were protected from the draft during that war?
Coal miners might be.
Farmers.
Farmers were.
There are particular groups.
Yeah. If they were needed to sustain,
maybe industrial, maybe engineers that ran like industrial, like automotive plants became making tanks and stuff like that.
Yeah.
They would have left those people in place. So if you had a needed job that helped facilitate the war or maintain the food chain, you were probably protected, but you got drafted.
Right.
Did you get to pick where you wanted to go or did they just stick you on what they wanted to stick you?
They put you where they want to.
I saw your draft papers. I didn't put them in the show, but I saw where your draft papers were and where you were drafted. And it basically said to any server, it basically said just to whatever server shows. So you got the U.S. Army. That's correct?
Yes.
U.S. Army. And then you went to training, I guess. And were you married when you got drafted or were you just getting ready to get married?
Good question.
You don't remember? Hey, at 100 years, you have a right. So did you
I think he would have to get married because then Jerry was born.
You got married because you had Jerry.
Yeah.
Mamie was pregnant with Jerry when you went off, right?
Right.
Right. Okay. So that's good question. So my dad, how old's dad? Dad's about 78, 79.
Yeah, something like that.
So you had dad. So that's about 78. 89 years ago, you went off to the Army. Where were you stationed? Where did you go in the military?
Camp Stewart, Georgia.
Camp Stewart, Georgia, and you were trained there.
Yes.
And then you were shipped overseas. And where was your first deployment? You went over to Africa?
In Africa, yeah.
Your autobiography says you went your first trip was to Casablanca.
Right on.
He tells the story in his autobiography. I love this. My grandpa says he was on the boat going to Casablanca. That's Morocco, Tunisia, Algeria, those kind of areas. He was going to northern part of Africa. And he says on the way there, they were on the boat and they were actually showing them the movie Casablanca. Mm-hmm. And he never got to see the end of it because they had a U-boat get near their ship and they had to extinguish the lights and the sound to hide from the U-boat. And so they turned off the lights. He never saw the end of the movie. And your memoirs say you just saw it, you know, 15, 20 years ago.
Yes.
Yeah. Right. You went to Casablanca, you saw the first part of the movie, and you didn't see the rest half till 70 years later.
Right on.
Did the movie turn out good?
It's not much of a movie as far as I'm concerned, really.
Well, you didn't miss anything.
No.
No. Did the U-boat find you guys?
No.
It didn't find you. Praise God for that. So you went over to Morocco, you were in Northern Africa, you were in the army. Were you stationed with a certain battalion? What general, what group?
It was a battalion. We were always independent and be attached then to a division, but we were a battalion.
And so would you be mostly with tank divisions and stuff like that in those days, or what kind of groups?
Whatever you were assigned to.
You would go to.
But we were anti-aircraft.
Anti-aircraft. Yeah. Did you ever get a chance to see Patton? I hear Patton went to Africa, too. George Patton, the famous general?
No.
He was a big general. We see. He went to Africa with the tanks, and he went to Germany. I want to see that. There's a couple good pictures of Grandpa here. I want to show you this real quick here. This picture here is a picture of you, Grandpa, sitting next to a medic truck.
Yeah.
That's Grandpa. And he looks good. He's like, I mean, he's a handsome dude. There's another picture of you driving a car, a big old black car with somebody in it. You're in military gear and you're driving it and there's hills and stuff. So I don't know if you're in Italy or where you're at in that. It looks like it could be Italy or someplace. And then there's another great picture of you with five other deployed men. On one of the hats, it has Sammy. It says one guy's name's Hill, one guy's name's Sammy, and then one guy's name, it looks like McCann or something like that. And there's some other guys there. It looks like some of the guys you served with. That looks like probably over at a local fort, maybe when you were in here. But these are great pictures. Here's another one of Grandpa. Grandpa's got another great picture. Beth and I saw this one. It's you sitting in the Italian Alps. Do you remember that picture of you up on the hill, the Italian Alps?
No.
He's done so much stuff, he doesn't remember the best things he's done. Isn't that great? And there's another picture of him with two other service guys. Grandpa's the guy in the middle. He's a small guy in the middle. Another picture of him in his gear on the right in front of a barracks there as well. So just some good shots of you in Italy. When you had to go to war and deployment and all that stuff, I know you started teaching Sunday school at 17 years of age.
Yeah.
How did you handle being drafted and then going into war? People were hurting each other, you know, to try to grab power and authority. How did you maintain your faith through the process of being drafted and pulled away from whatever you wanted to do in your life, from the birth of your son, Jerry? How did you handle being pulled away, pushed into this world war? How did your faith carry you through that process?
I had a good faith. And the military was good to me. They would go send me to any church service that I wanted to go. A lot of times they'd give me a truck. That's all they had. And I'd drive wherever the service was. So the Army took good care of me as a religious person.
Did you go to just Army services or did you go to local services of other people?
No, Army services.
Army services. Mm-hmm. And were they real good about, in those days, were people able to express their faith in the Army and share their faith in Christ openly?
Yes.
Today, it's a lot more guarded today. You know, they can go to the chaplain, but the chaplain today it has to represent all faiths. And if somebody comes up that's into witchcraft or Satanism or this or that, they kind of have to be a chaplain to all people. They're more of a counselor these days. But in those days, people unapologetically had faith in Christ, had faith in God, and really trusted in the Lord. Is that true?
Right on.
Wow, that's amazing. And so you got a chance to go to church. You maintained your faith. I can't imagine all the things you experienced and saw. You went to North Africa, correct?
Yes.
You started in Africa. And then eventually you were relocated. Where did you go after you finished the battles in Africa? You pushed the Germans out.
Naples.
So did you leave Africa because the Germans were finished there pretty much? Yeah. You guys pretty much defeated them.
Yes.
Okay, and then you went to Naples, Italy, Yes. being our home country.
Yes.
You know, when you got to Italy, did you knock on the door of the king and said, the Benetones are back?
No way.
I think you should have knocked on the door and said, we're back. And he would have said, oh, you're the family that renounced me. So you weren't nervous about that. So you were back in Italy. You landed in Naples.
Yes.
I didn't know that. So that's something I've learned. So that could explain, actually, Beth. That could explain. Let me switch pictures here. That could explain this picture. That picture of that car could be Naples. Mm. That could easily be Naples. Naples has got Mount Vesuvius and the hills by it. Right. And those hills look about like where we've been. We've been on that road, on the coastal road. There's a picture here in an army car. I would love to know where that is. It has no designation on it. Do you remember where you were driving that?
That car?
Yeah.
The war was over when...
Praise God.
When and just picked that car up.
You just picked the car up?
Really?
Okay, Grandpa.
It's just side of the road.
You jacked the car. Let's just be honest with you.
Well, no.
So just stuff was left everywhere.
Yeah.
Really? Yeah. It was just there. But
it needed a battery.
So you found a battery?
And I found a battery. And it started.
Where were you when you found the car? Were you in Italy someplace?
Yes.
And you drove it back. Where'd you drive it to? Back to Naples?
Yes.
That's a great looking ride.
But then the army or the government said, no more. You can't have this stuff. So we had to turn it in.
Probably some general got it and drove it around after that. Who's in the car with you? Some friend?
That I can't answer.
You can't remember?
No.
But just somebody that was riding along with you trying to get back. Were you just trying to get back to the ships to get back home?
No. No.
Were you on hold over there waiting to see what they were going to do with you?
Oh, yes.
So you told me the other day, I didn't know this, but Grandpa said that when they finished the Germans off and the war was over, he said that he didn't get to just go home.
No.
They put him on hold because they weren't sure whether they were going to send him to Japan next.
Right on.
So they were thinking they would have to go to Japan next. Hmm. And then, of course, we know that ultimately the president decided to drop the two bombs, and that broke the will of the Japanese emperor, and that war was over.
And we were glad.
And you were glad.
At that time. Because we knew we were ready to go to Japan.
You were going to be heading to Japan next, yeah. And that would have been a heck of a boat ride.
Right.
Yeah, that would have been terrible. So it was a huge decision. So when they talk about the decision to use the bomb, and, you know, it was devastating, but at the same time, it saved millions of lives.
Right.
Gosh, can you just imagine? My grandpa's, you know, we're here because that decision was made, I guess, obviously, because, I mean, he was the lone male that could have, you know, children and descendants. So when you know, the emperor, him and I were talking coming to the studio today, that one of the generals for the Japanese army, before they attacked Pearl Harbor, they kind of told the emperor, don't do it. If we do this, we're gonna wake a sleeping giant, basically. And they did. And of course we engaged the Japanese, you know, we were talking about today in the car, what if they had not attacked us? You know, we may have stayed out of the Asian war. We may have just said, oh, that's their problem. We've had enough of the Germans. And, you know, the world could look different today. But then they attacked us. And Grandpa said, well, there's no use figuring that out. They did it, and that's where we are.
Yeah.
And, you know, the emperor took bad advice, and next thing you know, the emperor was embarrassed, and he basically was humiliated, and he yielded, and he recognized the superiority of America. So I don't know when the Japanese attacked America, whether they were realizing they're a small islander people, and they were attacking a nation that goes more than 3,000 miles across with lots of people in it. We were trying to figure out how in the world did they think they could occupy it, you know? But in your mind, you know, you just, power corrupts and you do things, and war is terrible. Tell me about some of the opportunities you had, you know, during the war to connect with people, and where your faith kind of kept you through it during the battles, during your work as what did you do in the military?
I was a medic.
You were a medic. And were you trained medically? How did you get picked as a medic?
On one of the questionnaires, they asked what you'd done, and I'd gone to some classes on medicine for the coal miners, which they taught the coal miners, and I went as a kid to this class, and so I had a little bit of background of bones and first aid, so they needed whatever they could
and they, get. So basically, you had some coal miner training as a kid.
Right.
And they go, well, here's a warm one. He would be the best for a medic. Right. And then they gave you some additional training, I guess.
Oh, yeah. Then they sent me to school. actually to the hospital, and you went every day, all day long.
And what they do, teach you how to stop bleeding and help people get stabilized?
Yes, yes.
Did you do much of that in the war? Were you engaged? Did you see people injured and hurt?
Everything.
You saw everything.
But fortunately, sometimes it didn't bother you. But at least you were trained.
You were trying to help people and trying to help them, yeah.
Right on.
Were you in the middle of any of the battles that went on? Did it get pretty hairy from time to time?
Yes, yes.
Well, in those times, were you able to, your faith in Christ, your faith in God, was that able to give you some comfort? Were you able to support people and each other through that time? What got you through those moments when you're seeing people lose their lives, you're seeing people devastatingly injured, you've got life and death there? How do you cope with those times? We don't deal with a lot of that today. We deal with, like, people feel like their life's going to end when their social media account gets hacked, or they have a bad hair day. And we think we have it tough, but how did you get through those days?
Well, I had a strong faith that things would get better. God would take care of me, and he did.
That's good.
I'm still here.
You're still here. You're still here doing very well, Grandpa. It's just a matter of living life right. Now, when you were a medic, so you were attached to different battalions, different groups of people. You met lots of different people from the war. Were you mostly with people from Southern Illinois, Illinois area, or did it get completely mixed up?
It's mixed up.
It's mixed up.
A lot. And around New Jersey, New York.
So you had to deal with a bunch of those New York and New Jersey. Did they do that because you were an Italian? They thought you could put up with them?
I don't know.
Did you see a lot of Italians in the war?
Saw some.
Some. What did the Italian people think when the Americans came into Italy and then the liberation of Italy from Germany? How did that go?
Well, they liked us. They liked it. We came in.
Well, you know, the Italy's been controlled by everybody, you know, through their ear. Everybody in history has taken over Italy. And in Italy, as long as you let the wine go and you can have siesta in the afternoon, more or less the Italians are kind of, hey, it's okay. But the Germans were very, very harsh to the Italians. Mm-hmm. And so the Italians did not fare well with the Germans. They didn't play well. Mm-hmm. So when they left, how long did it take the Italians to begin to be excited about the Americans winning the war over there?
I can't answer that. I don't know.
Did they celebrate? Were they excited?
Yeah.
When the war's done?
Yeah.
So you stayed in Naples a little longer. You eventually came back to the United States. So they eventually said, Japan's done. You can go home.
We left Naples and went on up to Switzerland.
Okay.
So we got to visit some of the major cities. No fighting there. The war was over. But we got to visit and see historical places from Rome on up to the Swiss border.
That's just amazing. That's just amazing. Now, what I want to come to in part two here is I want to ask you this. Real seriously, Grandpa, you've been teaching Sunday school since you were 17 years old.
Yes.
You've taught class up into your 90s. He literally taught Sunday school class into his 90s. He's been a member his whole life of the Heron Methodist Church, and just been a great person doing that. I've been in his classes as a kid. My faith is inspired. I got involved with church because my grandparents took me to church when I would come visit them. And when they would come to Memphis, where I grew up, they got me connected to church there. So my faith today is highly connected to them attaching me. There's a lot of people you've walked with over the years in your faith. What has it been like teaching people about Christ since you were 17? So that's over 80 years. It's been a part of that. You've been through the Bible a few times.
Yes.
What's the general thing that you think's important about the study of the Bible and helping people come to know their faith and their faith in Christ?
I can't answer that. I don't.
Yeah. But I mean, what's been your goal? Why have you done it? What's your motivation? What's been your motivation to teach that long?
I wanted everybody to know God or go to heaven.
Amen. So
here's the point.
So it's a good investment of your time. Now, when we come back in part two here, we're going to keep going here in a minute, but in part two, Grandpa, we want to look at when you came back and how you transitioned by faith. You got through the war and you come back, and the war actually, you'll find out in part two here, the war kind of becomes an opportunity for you to change the trajectory of your life, and I would say the life of the Benitones. And so we'll talk about that here in part two.
There are more than 8 billion phones in the world, a fact that threatens your privacy, security, and health. With Silent Pocket Faraday Protection, you can regain control over your mobile devices. We get it. Privacy and security are inconvenient topics. And you may feel like you have nothing to hide, but the fact is that in the modern world, your laptop is never really off. Your phone emits a signal, even in airplane mode. And everything from your passport to your credit cards contains RFID, and all of it contains valuable private information that is easily exploited in the wrong hands. Silent Pocket offers a range of products you already use: wallets, bags, travel gear, laptop sleeves, key cases. But with the added protection of our patented Faraday technology, which turns your devices invisible and safe from the outside world. Many industries, from top business professionals to government officials, require the use of Faraday products for the day-to-day security of them and their staff. They understand that we are constantly at risk and take the necessary steps to prevent future attacks. We offer this elite technology to anyone that values their personal data, and we are proud to offer a premium range that fits seamlessly into your everyday life, providing security without looking like a tinfoil hat. As we learn to live with technology, Silent Pocket stands on the three pillars of privacy, security, and health. Our goal is to provide harmony with mobile technology without risking our most valuable information. We hope you'll trust us to help you do the same. There are more than 8 billion phones in the world, a fact that threatens your privacy, security, and health. With Silent Pocket Faraday Protection, you can regain control over your mobile devices. We get it. Privacy and security are inconvenient topics, and you may feel like you have nothing to hide, but the fact is that in the modern world, your laptop is never really off. Your phone emits a signal, even in airplane mode. And everything from your passport to your credit cards contains RFID, and all of it contains valuable private information that is easily exploited in the wrong hands. Silent Pocket offers a range of products you already use: wallets, bags, travel gear, laptop sleeves, key cases. But with the added protection of our patented Faraday technology, which turns your devices invisible and safe from the outside world. Many industries, from top business professionals to government officials, require the use of Faraday products for the day-to-day security of them and their staff. They understand that we are constantly at risk and take the necessary steps to prevent future attacks. We offer this elite technology to anyone that values their personal data, and we are proud to offer a premium range that fits seamlessly into your everyday life, providing security without looking like a tinfoil hat. As we learn to live with technology, Silent Pocket stands on the three pillars of privacy, security, and health. Our goal is to provide harmony with mobile technology without risking our most valuable information. We hope you'll trust us to help you do the same.